I guess that would be the same here in Australia. Similar, about talking about 2 tonnes per head, but of course the average Australian is up at about 20 tonnes per person, so you've got a much tougher job ahead of you to get down there. How do we get down there? Well, yes, there are technical ways and there are lifestyle ways, and I'm trying to partition those different things. So I've got two hypothetical households here. One is called the Watts, the well-off techie greenie household, and the Lills, the low-income lifestyle greenie household. They're both trying to get their emissions down as far as they can by their own personal choices. They can't affect the background here. That's the government thing. They can't do anything about that, so that's a kind of millstone stuck around their neck right at the beginning before they start. The Watt family, their rule is that they're not going to make any lifestyle changes that would make their peers laugh at them. So they're rich, they've got loads of money, they can invest anything they want in trying to reduce their carbon emissions. They have to do it entirely technologically, they're not going to make any lifestyle changes. Whereas the Lill family, on the other hand, are completely the opposite. They haven't got much money, they can't invest in fancy technology themselves, but they're prepared to make any change, any lifestyle change within reason, that is going to reduce their carbon emissions. Now, how do they fare? I have to say that the Watt family, although the total outcome is higher than the British average, it's much, much lower than other people of the same income, because your carbon emissions do reflect your income a lot. There's a very, very strong monotonic relationship between income and carbon emissions on average. Just to go through them, look, can you see that yellow bit at the top? Their house energy, that's much less than the average, because that's something that is subject to a technical fix. You can buy yourself a very nice low energy house. In fact, we can even nearly get down to zero these days. If you've got enough money, you can do that. So they've gone and done that. Then it comes down to the red bit. Now, what happens with very people with loads and loads of money is that they spend a lot of it on travel. So if that family are behaving the same as everybody else, they might get a Prius or something fancy like that. They might have a very low energy thing, but they do so many more miles. Rich people do that. That's one of the things they do, that they've got a much, much higher emission level for that. And it's the same with the air travel. You see both car travel and air travel. Rich people travel a lot by air. It's really astounding how much they do. Then when it comes to the food bit, it's not very much different from the rich. Rich people don't actually eat a lot more than others. They eat flashier things, but they would also be able to eat carefully. They've got loads of money, so they can always buy organic, various other things. They can spend money and do things. So they can make a little bit of effort there, and it's slightly smaller. When it comes to spending on goods, although they buy more, they buy much more carefully. They buy very good quality products that last a long time, heirloom stuff. So the net result, when we've gone through all those calculations, is that it's not much different from the average. So they end up actually rather similar to the average, even though their income is much higher. Now we look at the lifestyle family, and we see they have succeeded in making quite a substantial drop. But they haven't done so well on the house energy bit, because they can't afford to have a flash eco house. You know, what they've done is that they've turned the thermostat down, they've worn lots of thermal underwear, they've shut the curtains at night, they've done everything they possibly can from a lifestyle point of view, but that has not succeeded in reducing it by an enormous amount. It's probably about half what the normal is, but they haven't done as well as the Watts on that side. When it comes to transport, they just said, of air travel, they've just said, we're not going to do it. So they cut that out immediately, just by not flying, because flying is inessential. It's something you could not do if you don't have to. But surface transport, you do need to do a bit of it, and they do it through public transport, bicycles, etc., all the usual things you would think of. They don't have a family car. It depends where you live. In some cases, you would absolutely need to have a private family car, but generally speaking, in a city, you don't necessarily need it. So they've managed to shrink that quite a lot. On the food side, they've looked carefully about what is a low-carbon diet, and they've discovered as we all ought to know, that it's to do with the animal product content of your food that's the biggest component of the carbon emissions associated, not carbon dioxide, but methane and nitrous oxide emissions, which are very important greenhouse gases. The biggest thing you could do is to reduce the meat content, and they've gone as far as cutting it out completely, with a few other things, perhaps a bit of organic stuff, more local food, less processed food. So they've managed to make quite a big reduction there. As far as goods are concerned, they haven't got any money, so they can't afford to buy much. They try to buy carefully, but they've reduced that to a reasonable minimum. Their share of the infrastructure is exactly the same, but you can see that they've got it down to nearly half. It's quite interesting, just by sheer lifestyle main force, you might say. Okay, we're still way away from where we're trying to get to. Can we get it any closer than that? We can imagine that in 20 years' time, technology would have moved on. The kind of technology that will be available to ordinary householders will have moved on quite a lot. So, but again, this is something I would like to challenge people. If we're trying to design these mixtures of lifestyle and technology, what would we choose that would have the biggest effect and have a reasonable amount of take-up? When it comes to house energy, again, we're sure by 2030 the technology of new houses will have improved a lot. So we can assume that could be very small. And air travel, even if they're doing the same amount of air travel, probably aeroplanes will be somewhat better by 2030. But there seems to be no absolute technical fix for air travel at the moment. There seems to be no way, unless by 2030 we've got into hydrogen-fueled aeroplanes, but at the moment nobody can quite see how that's going to happen, or possibly biofueled aeroplanes. But that's going to be extremely difficult to work out. Cars probably will be a lot better, and that's reflected in this bit. And as far as the food is concerned, again, still, there's not really much of a technical fix. You know, there just isn't a way to fix a cow or a sheep, really. Although it's possible to imagine that whatever can be done has been done by 2030. For example, there are experiments now where you're changing the feed in cows, and so that the actual amount of non-CO2 greenhouse gases come out is 10-20% better. Unfortunately, of course, then that means that you're tending to compete with human food as well. So it's treating cows rather like pigs, which reduces the CO2 a bit but causes more problems elsewhere in the system. But I won't go into that at the moment. But still, it seems to show that without some kind of change there doesn't seem to be a technical fix. When it comes to the goods, again, some of the background decarbonisation that's been going on would have affected the efficiency of goods production, so that would have reduced that a little bit. And similarly, the background infrastructure, we could expect that to have certainly gone down by 2030. Now, when we come to the lills, the same sort of background processes have occurred to shrink those a little bit more. They're still not down to the level that we're aiming at. And if the bad news from the climate scientists continues, it may be that even that is too high, and we'll have to get even lower than that. So now what are we going to do after that? It looks as if we've just about reached a limit there, unless anybody can think of really much cleverer ways of living a modern life with low carbon. If we wanted to get below that, we've got to go to the technology. In other words, there's got to be some background decarbonisation of the whole society so that the inputs represented by these various segments are themselves net zero emitters. And in most cases, we can imagine how that could be done. But in the case of, for example, food, for example, it's difficult to see that. Anything that remains above that line has got to be balanced by something below the line. In other words, they've got to be active managed sinks that we've got to create. And at the moment, we don't have any active managed sinks. We've only got plants, really, and that's tricky. We need the plants for all sorts of other purposes, and so it's hard to see where we're going to get these sinks from at the moment.